We're going to talk to you for a second just about the setup. This is the first co-sponsored lecture between the School of Architecture and the Sequential Artists Workshop. So I wanted Aaron to say a few words about the Sequential Artists Workshop.
So the Sequential Artists Workshop is located downtown, and it is a grassroots educational system to train new cartoonists. And if you haven't seen Aidan's work and you have this pretty sunny Sunday funnies kind of idea of what that is, she'll break that down a little bit, but of course it includes all of that, and it's very student-oriented. It's a year-long program, but they also offer community courses that happen during the summer and also spring break. So some people this past week, while y'all were doing whatever you were doing at the beach or traveling, we were hanging out with Aidan, and she was teaching us her processes. So that was a really wonderful experience.
And Aaron teaches in the art school, Aaron Burr. So
yeah, I just finished the program at the University of Florida in sculpture, and I did comics as well, and I've taught here.
Okay. And so last year I actually took Aidan's class and was lucky enough to sit in on it. I've been fascinated by the Sequential Artist Workshop for a while because it seems to me that architecture is a sequential art form. I think it fits very well into that category. I took a class with her, and it was fantastic. And thought about having her come and talk to you guys, because fundamentally, architecture is really complex spatially and temporally, as you guys know. It's impossible to capture in a single image, and so when we investigate it or when we try to represent something about it, we tend to combine images, and we spend a lot of our time thinking about representation and how do we take something that's spatially very complex and begin to make images that come together to say more than a single image can. And it's very much in conversations with Tom Hart, who's the head of the Sequential Artists Workshop. We have some of his students here. And so I kind of went and hung around Tom for a while and said, hey, I want to talk to you, and we talked. And it seems like what they do and what we do have a lot to share with each other. It's not a direct correspondence, but there's this question of architecture as experienced in time. And so it has a narrative arc to it, and how do you begin to bring that narrative arc and the spatial complexity into the kind of compound images that we make, particularly in first and second year. We really focus on those in the curriculum, but as you get older and further in the curriculum, you're asked to do that yourself, to invent drawings that say very complex things about architecture. And it seemed to me that comic books had something to offer us that isn't our usual place where we go looking for inspiration. So I've talked to Tom and Aaron and Aidan about this idea, and so we're studying this out. We're hoping to have more of them. Tom's going to introduce Aidan quickly, and then we'll go straight to the lecture.
Thanks. I will be quick. I wrote this. I'm looking at my phone because it's something I wrote a while ago. And it's like four or five sentences long, and I'll try and expand maybe one sentence or two. I wrote, this was for a book cover, so it was supposed to be succinct. Aidan Koch's work is profound and unique. Okay, that's just simple. I actually like this sentence. Every once in a while, I like, what's the sentence? Few cartoonists have such equalized sensitivity to visual detail, social detail, symbol, sound, and story as she does.
That's a good sentence.
It is a good sentence. I'll just let Aidan's talk expand upon that. I actually really like this sentence too. But I said, she will be remembered for creating a new form of attention. And that the art form is suffering, the art form is suffering shockwaves from this earliest work. I don't know how to expand upon that without just letting Aidan talk. I should just let him talk.
Sure.
Okay.
Thank you for
your
time.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
So much, Nina, Tom, Saw, students, peoples, for letting me come here and discuss some things with you. So this has ended up kind of being a combination lecture of one that I did in class the other day, but also interspersing it with a ton of different details and information about topics that I think are really important, one of which is basically, you know, visual communication, which is so essential to comics, and seeing how they evolve or have evolved. And definitely, and taking that into a historical perspective is really important to me, just because that's really where I look a lot of the times and the work that I'm drawn to. I spend a lot of time in museums. I live in New York. I like go to the Met all the time. I go to MoMA all the time. I go to the Cloisters. So I think looking at history is a really great way to ground yourself in what visual tools are effective and how they've been effective over thousands of years. So I'm going to kind of, I mean, this is pretty chronological, but there's little parts in here where I jump to the future or jump to examples of how things are working now, or how we've looked back on these tools and used them for present day comic and art work. So I just want to start with obviously one of the most clear examples of where kind of art history begins, where visual communication begins, which is cave paintings. And looking at those, I think are really clear examples of how people needed visual communication and how it kind of, you know, came out of nowhere, and how we use it as a tool to see how people lived and what was important to different people. So when I see these, you know, since we don't have anyone from that time to tell us what they were thinking about, what their cultures were like, what their communities were like, we look to these things and we try and decipher them based on what we know about how visual communication now, or within the time that people have been able to write about it. So, you know, looking at these and being like, okay, what's being depicted here? You know, mostly animals. So were these animals part of a spiritual ideology? Were these, you know, depictions of hunting? Were these depictions of people? These are really our only clues as to understanding how people lived, or at least like what was important to them. Apart from finding like tools and houses and structures and bones, this is something that people, you know, they took extra time. It wasn't out of necessity that they did this. It was definitely part of some creative influence or a need for a certain artistic communication, even just a need to explain to other people and other generations what was important to them at the time. And another interesting thing is, like, you know, an image like this has actual different generational art together. So finding these things for us is amazing, because you also see how styles change and how and even how like expression changed over this period of time. So some of the first kind of symbols that we start seeing is with counting stones. Which counting stones were developed basically for trade. So keeping track of, you know, how many sheep that guy took from you, or how many vases you sold to someone. And it's really, you know, it's a really basic thing of, you know, a stone representing a sheep. And you can kind of see where that, you know, would start leading to writing, or leading to more legible, like, accounts of what kind of what was going on. And also something that is very much, would be very much democratic in terms of people knowing what these symbols meant in their culture, because everyone would have been trading back and forth all the time. So at this point still, like, even if it was maybe mildly non-representational, anyone in that society probably would have known what each of these symbols meant. So here's some more counting stones. And so this is some examples of like cuneiform, which was really one of the first versions of writing, or basically of like glyphs, which are symbols that are representing objects or things. So that was really the Sumerians who were working in cuneiform. And this is also an example of kind of like how like really representational symbols kind of started transforming. And Sumerians were some of the first that really started restricting their symbols. So, you know, going from something that's super representational, that anyone could understand what it is a depiction of, And kind of simplifying that enough so that you get the idea of what something is referring to. So that kind of makes it so, you know, maybe in that community, because of the style, it was still enough of a representation that kind of anyone could tell what it was. But maybe to outsiders, it could be harder. And especially because those images would have developed from the items that were important to that culture. So you really learn a lot about, you know, what was currency to them. The fact that they had sheep, you know, you learn something about that. So that becoming an image of representation or symbol. And same with, you know, spirituality. You kind of see what was important in a culture based on what becomes part of its symbology. And obviously, you know, I think one of our immediate things when we think about with symbols or with ancient languages is hieroglyphs. And I know, like, you know, for me as a child, looking at this stuff was immediately magnetic. Just because it's really beautiful in the way that it was formed as a language, like the style of it is really aesthetically pleasing, I think, to most people. And also, it, you know, it has that, like, part of their spirituality is really like cryptic and cool even. The types of symbols that they were drawn to, the things that were active in their environments are really interesting. And even the complexity of their god system and the things that they're interested in are really, the like imagery behind it is really, to me, really attractive. And so a lot of that, again, was formed from parts of their spiritual practice, like images that were important, you know, the eye of Horus or whatever, and different, you know, birds and yeah, like body parts. And this image, I think, is kind of good to look at too, because it has a breakdown of like illustrative imagery and symbolic imagery and language. So even at this point, this written language, as much as you could try and understand what it is based on the representational pictures, you're like, okay, so if there's a bird and then there's a snake, maybe it has to do with like a predator prey. You know, you can make, there's a lot of guesswork that you can do based on what the images are representing, but by having this like much more illustrative representational imagery next to it, it gives you a lot more basis to go off of into how to start forming your interpretation, and gives you a lot more context. So, you know, from a foreigner or from someone, you know, thousands of years later looking at this, the imagery that's more descriptive, the illustrations, you kind of immediately understand. And even like the way that it's placed in hierarchies allows you to kind of understand, like, you know, kind of catching cattle and like raising animals versus maybe, you know, cultivating fruits and vegetables versus, you know, all these kind of different layers that you're kind of, you're seeing the hierarchy and can begin to make a lot of guesses off of that, at least in terms of what was important to this culture. And how we can start imagining what their lifestyles were like. Kind of same here, but then as hieroglyphs started being used, or like, you know, became more common, it also, they kind of eventually became hieratic script, which is a much more condensed format and much more difficult to make guesses from. A lot of the symbols were so condensed down into abstracts that, you know, by the time that we found things, it took the Rosetta Stone to understand any of it. Beyond that, it was definitely just a lot of guesswork based on being like, bird, person, man, crown. So, you know, at some level, we can decide to understand that however we want. But because it's so abstracted, it's a lot harder to make more solid guesswork as to what it might actually mean. But here's like, you know, individual symbols, though, are usually much easier to kind of get grips on what they might understand or what they might mean. Just because the level of representation in them is kind of, it's readable to pretty much everyone. You know, certain aspects of it might be really environmentally specific. You know, if you've never seen a baboon before and you saw this, you might have no idea what's going on. So it definitely takes kind of a level of information surrounding what you know already or what you're familiar with in order to understand these things. But you know, definitely the level of representation gives you a lot of clues. So that kind of was popping up all over the world at similar times. This is kind of more like Mayan, South American, which they had a really intense, complex style of glyph writing or pictorial language. But even this, you can kind of see, like, you know, I just pull this stuff from wherever doing searches, but all of these pretty much have like question marks after them. So even here, it's like, it's just a wild guess as to like what it really meant. And even at this point too, you know, when we go back and start studying these things, since they maybe haven't been on our radar as, you know, a species for a while, or as like Western culture, certain things might not exist anymore too, and we'll never have any way of quite understanding what it was. But here's some Maya too, and you know, and for me too, like as a visual person, I think it's really interesting to just look at the styles, like Egyptian being much more like kind of narrow and angular, and the like cuneiform being more kind of like abstracted shapes, and looking at Mayan, which is like really like blocky and rounded, and you know, you see that reflected also in the sculpture and art and kind of everything that revolves around that culture, that they had a really solid, you know, style and visual aesthetic kind of for everything. And so, I mean, so kind of the changes that started to happen was basically like pictorial language started out as just a visual way of communicating, you know, visual, like the stones to this. But then as things start to get a little more subtle, as the language starts to get a lot more abbreviated or abstracted, it also becomes started to pair with phonetic language, which was kind of a big change. So that definitely takes it out of being easy to understand from a total outsider, at least, because then you have to understand the spoken language in order to understand how it also transfers to the visual language. And so that's something that's like starting to be shown here. I think a lot of us immediately can go to like kanji or Japanese or Chinese script as a way to see a lot of the beginnings of how visual language kind of developed. These are just like really, you know, simplified versions. But you can see where it kind of all began. And then slowly, you know, you would start putting together maybe the words and sounds for those things into those symbols so that you could start, it start became associated with phonetics. And so since this is kind of the transition where things no longer become just about symbolic representation, to me, one of the big changes is you kind of now get this separation where you have illustration and written language, and how those things play back and forth, supplementing one another. And so to me, that's also like really where comics comes into play. So I have a couple pages up here that are from John Berger's Way of Seeing, which if anyone hasn't read that, I like highly, highly recommend it. And before that comes Walter Benjamin's Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction. So both of those books really look at how in modern times and like any times really we take in imagery and really get down to the roots of it and really look at all the different ways that people are processing images on in their day-to-day life. So I'll just like read these little pages to give you like a brief idea about what that means. Consequently, a reproduction, as well as making its own reference to the image of its original, becomes itself the reference point for other images. The meaning of an image is changed according to what one sees immediately beside it or what comes immediately after it. Such authority, as it retains, is distributed over the whole context in which it appears. And so reproduction isolates a detail of a painting from the whole. The detail is transformed. An allegorical figure becomes a portrait of a girl. Adults and children sometimes have boards in their bedrooms or living rooms on which they pin pieces of paper, letters, snapshots, reproductions of paintings, newspaper cuttings, original drawings, postcards. On each board, all the images belong to the same language, and all are more or less equal within it, because they have been chosen in a highly personal way to match and express the experience of the room's inhabitant. Logically, these boards should replace museums. So I think that kind of gets it clear where going into like understanding comics by Scott McCloud, you know, he takes it down even further where he's like, this is exactly what comics are. Is what happens when you place images, text, in a sequential order, in the order that you would read anything. And people have, you know, you can't help but start putting those things together when they're placed in context with one another. You know, like the text here is something. If women knew then what they knew now. You know, that gives it such a loaded context, and it's, it gives you a different impression from if you just saw one of those paintings in a museum. You know, every way you place things together is gonna give you a different read or a different tone or a different way of approaching it and how it fits into, you know, what is going on. And so here's like a definition of comics. Plural in form, used with singular verb. One, juxtapose pictorial and other images in deliberate sequence, intended to convey information and or to produce an aesthetic response in the viewer. So jumping kind of back in time again, looking at where those things are transforming in different cultures, and really how they totally apply to comics, and apply to how we're reading information all the time. So, you know, something, this is like a little guidebook of some sort. You know, I can't actually read the language, but I get a kind of good idea about what is going on here, of kind of like do's and don'ts. or just like general instructional things of how to weave or something, or the best way to like carry your sticks home. It's really important because, you know, as much as you could write that out, word for word, give someone total instructions on something, you can do it so much faster with visuals. And there's like, it's much harder to misinterpret the visuals than it would be the language of it. And even here, you know, just like, it's just like a way of gathering information. So just a quick read of this, you automatically know it's all about like, you know, like costume and decoration within a culture, whether or not it is telling you about that. Looking at totem poles, which again in another, you know, jumping around the world a little bit, they're also kind of markers of different, of a lot of different things. Spiritual, they represent spoken stories, you know, they're specific to different tribes or different families. And a big thing too is that, you know, a lot of Native American culture circulates around stories that have animals in them. And all those animals, like the stories behind them have to do with different, like, personality attributes, basically, and different, like, logical reasonings into why things are the way they are. So the placement of those animals says something about what's important to that group or what's important to like that environment of where it is. You know, it could even represent different families based on the attributes that are associated with them. This is just, you know, like from the Wikipedia of it. But here's, you know, so here's kind of some different meanings of different animals. So definitely where you place it on the totem is really important and really says something different. Just looking at like prayer hands, and again, just seeing like how complex these little teeny nuances are, and how they have different meanings and how they're used and when they're used and who uses them. These kind of depictions where, you know, I don't totally know what's going on here, but I kind of can assume that it's like stories or information. You know, same here, we're just, again, too, like having these divisions of maybe each thing is kind of a separate story, or each thing has a separate importance overall. Just like these kind of practical ways that people divide up visual information, there's a lot that you can intuitively read into it. And again, like these are something where like the way that this is laid out is like pretty much exactly to like airplane safety cards, which it, you know, just kind of tells you that there's this natural way that we're looking at these images and can understand them in the way that they're placed together. And that they overlap so many different cultures too, you know, because something like this is supposed to be able to be read by anyone, and they need to be able to like understand it. So having visuals, you know, the more that you show of something, the more someone will be able to mimic it. Whereas if you go straight from like person, you know, persons on their seat and then persons on like a giant ramp out the airplane, you need to know step by step, like you're not gonna be able to do it otherwise. So the more you like lay out an image over time, the more you can see like all the little steps that it takes to get somewhere. So there's a lot of different ways to, you know, to even play with that in making pieces that have to do with time, whether you want to slow time down or speed time up. Even like Tibetan Buddha feet, like there's, I feel like almost all the ones that I see kind of have a different orientation of symbols around them. And Buddha feet are like, I guess, an example of, or they're, the idea is that they're like the last impression that Buddha ever made, or the only one that ever made on this earth. So they're really essential symbols. But then the fact that they're all different tells you something about the, you know, whoever was making it, you know, kind of what's important to them, or the things that they're kind of seeing within their idea of Buddha. And looking at like the Tibetan Wheel of Life, this is interesting because it takes time and makes everything happen at once. I feel like we're very used to thinking of things in a linear manner, you know, reading from one end to another, start to finish. But for them, it's, you know, just ingrained in that religion, ingrained in that culture, things are more about cycles. And so this kind of will represent different, you know, different things happening all at once in time. So by putting it in a circular format, the hierarchy isn't start to finish or top to bottom. It's going inwards. And so that, you know, it's like slightly cultural difference, and it does tell you a lot about their views of time and views of hierarchies. So there's some different examples of that. And another thing would be kind of like, so instead of viewing maybe a story where it's like everything goes in or everything goes down, there's a lot of examples everywhere kind of about everything happening at once. So because these are based in a single image plane, there's really no hierarchy here. It's just kind of wherever your eye takes you. So a lot of these have to do with, you know, like kind of different stories or different myths about different God, so you kind of jump around and can learn all these different things at once. And it's nice because it's really, yeah, it's like really up to the viewer to see where they want to go with that. And kind of what's, you know, what's calling out to them. And these things too, they're really loaded with information. So it takes a long time to process. And you can see all the little intricacies of different stories and different things happening at once. And again, like a lot of things too, there might be, this is all examples from the Mewa Ramayana, which is an Indian script that's like compiled of tons and tons of different stories. But most of those stories take place in one page. So it's compressing time into a space, basically. So the same character will show up all around this image, but each thing is a different scene happening at a different time. But, you know, for us, it's hard to, you know, having no context for the story, you have no hierarchy for like knowing actually what the story is, because for you it's all taking place at once. So you can gather all the information, but this again takes a certain knowledge of the actual background to these stories to understand. But again, kind of the same character or the same story playing out, but kind of all jumbled together at once visually. And so those, I actually was thinking, like, this is something I actually see all the time now in comics, but probably, you know, not someone who's maybe relating it directly to having read those scripts, but just because it is a tool in order to create an environment, to create and activate a space. So this is Elvis Studio, which I actually don't know if it's like one person or many or what their deal is, but, you know, they do a lot of imagery that are just like visual overload. And they're really effective in creating these insane environments where you kind of travel in and out of these different interactions and spaces. And it's, you know, it's another tool that's out there for communication, but, you know, part of that too is that you're really leaving it up to the viewer to kind of move in and around as they choose. So different people looking at these images might have totally different stories or interpretations come out of it. This is Brian Chippendale, who also, like, you know, I think a lot of it's kind of about building these different characters and how those characters interact in different worlds. Moving kind of more into, I guess, object. I mean, a lot of things you see are also like, it kind of becomes decorative too, which to me is important because then you're looking at how the actual function of the object might also relate to the story. So, you know, something like this where it's these different little stories happening in these different panels, but because this is like a beautiful cabinet, you know, it might be kind of in like a more like fancy woman's boudoir. So looking at how, you know, the stories on it probably are appealing to the person who owns it somehow, or have to do with the actual function of the object, to like have clothes in it, or have manuscripts, or have, you know, any number of things. And that also is like an important thing to consider. Again, on a cabinet. And also, and I mean, and the natural structure gives itself to giving those panels or making those panels exist. And taking that even further into like abstracts, you know, a cabinet like this, thinking about how where you place objects changes the interpretation of how they interact together, or what, you know, what that says about the owner. And that's something that I've seen before in, like, this is a installation by Bastien Aubry that actually was at a comic festival called Fumetto, which I thought was really interesting to see someone already kind of linking those things together and how these operate in, you know, kind of in a visual language or whatever kind of way. It really like directly transfers over. Here's some more work of theirs. And of course, looking at maps is, you know, one of the most important historical ways, at least, of really delivering a lot of information, and a lot of necessary information as trade developed, as travel and exploration developed. Because if you're going somewhere new, you want as much information as you can get. So figuring out if a place that you're going, you know, has friendly people, or if it's a big city, what kind of crops are there or can be there, what kind of forest, where's the water? Like really basic questions that maps help people with understanding new environments. And so they've always been really effective communicators of so many different things. This one's really nice. You know, like, are there grasshoppers there? Are they bad? Are there, you know, and even I guess the structure of this one's cool too, of having different orientations. Like, is it dangerous water? Like, whether or not there's monsters, you know, you get the idea, like, is it dangerous? Yes, is there ice there? Is it glacial? Is it cold? Is it hot? And I think, you know, even now, like, whenever I travel, you know, I have to look at maps all the time. Like, luckily now, you know, you can use your smartphone most places, But you still, like, when you go to like a hostel or hotel in any city and pick up a map, a lot of the symbols are totally, they're ones that anyone understands if they've traveled before or if they've looked at a map before. You know, where to find camping, where to find restaurants, where to find the beach. So it's definitely something that, you know, we all very actively use every day. And again, like, you know, maps are made totally based on the importance of the audience. So whether or not it's just traveling somewhere, whether or not it's, you know, looking for gold, it, you know, maps are made very subjectively, I guess. And again, looking at, you know, form, Roman and Greek vases, something too where, you know, they're totally covered in stories all the time, and different hierarchies of stories. So, you know, choosing those stories based on the function of the object is an important thing. Whether or not that object will hold water might change the type of stories on it, versus whether or not it's for, like, being filled with blood or flowers. You know, there's a certain, you can either play with the juxtaposition of that image, or it can be something that's descriptive of the history of, you know, the object or the material that's going inside. And again, this is something that, you know, this is some contemporary work by ceramicist Magdalena Suarez Frimquez, who again, like, takes that to the next level too, of creating pottery, but then actually just putting comics on it. And a lot of her work, like, appropriates comics and cartoons from different ages and kind of smashes it all together. As well as even, like, she uses a lot of, like, Mayan characters or symbology. Jumping ahead, or back, I guess. So again, like how we saw the Buddha hands before, this is all Christian symbols. So, you know, thinking about how, you know, how you see Christ's hand in different paintings will tell you something about when that painting was made and where it was made, or like what, you know, what the message going out was. And Oriental rugs also, pretty much all the decorations in them have some kind of, you know, you can break it down to some kind of meaning. Most of the meaning, it's not going to necessarily be, you know, a story, or it's not necessarily going to be all that descriptive. You know, a lot of it was decorative, but all of it came from symbols of things that were prominent in that community or prominent to those people. Yeah, so you see all kinds of different motifs and embellishments of those motifs. And also, you know, again, too, they'll change a little bit based on the function of the rug. So there's a lot of rugs that are, you know, they're like camel bags, or there's ones, you know, a prayer rug versus a wedding rug versus a rug that covers your tent and keeps it cool. And so some of it, you know, it goes back of mildly representational to kind of more pattern-like or floral or ornamental. And whether or not a rug is like a medallion-based rug, so it's a centralized thing that expands outward, versus prayer rugs, which are one-directional, because when you're praying on it, it faces, you know, you're kind of facing it. And this is a wedding rug too, and a lot of wedding rugs, you know, I think it was like the mother would work on it. And so it would have little messages and little like hopes and prayers for the future of that marriage. And more contemporary rugs too actually have a lot of, they carry a lot of new things with them. You know, they're not just kind of reproducing same old imagery just for a market. A lot of it has developed with more contemporary themes. You actually see a lot of rugs now that will have like machine guns or drones, or, you know, it's gotten kind of crazy, but it is really a testament to what has happened in that environment over time and what is around them now. And going to, you know, Christian illustrated books, I think this is an interesting time because this is a very straightforward like illustration text. Which is a lot of what we take in growing up, and what we think of for how like image and text works together. But this is also a stage where like there's very little writing here compared to there is like imaginative decoration. And in this case too, like not all this decoration necessarily has to do with the text. It kind of goes back and forth into maybe how it informs one another. And so a lot of it was still, it was also about like visual enjoyment and visual expression. And motifs of that age. And even, you know, like illustrated letter forms. You know, part of it is about like the pleasure of taking in this information. And especially with, you know, religious experiences, you know, before like, you know, Puritans or something, you know, there's still this like kind of grandeur about the imagery behind a lot of Western religion. And that was part of what was, you know, attractive and exciting about participating, I think. You know, and stained glass is really obvious in the way that it breaks down stories. And so, you know, when you're in a church or something, that's a big part of what you might remember. What impacts you is the power of the light going through these stories and shining down onto your body is like pretty amazing. An amazing way to like not only share information, but make it a more, you know, experiential thing. Looking at like Hieronymus Bosch, this I thought was cool because he's, you know, this is one of the only times like in this age of Western art that you actually see the same kind of layout as I showed with the Tibetan Wheel of Light. So, you know, creating this kind of more like circular hierarchy that's not necessarily linear, a linear construction or message in any way. And even this too, where it's like, it's not about time passing, it's about three worlds coexisting. And again, like, you know, even from afar, you kind of get an immediate read on the differences between these three places. Looking at like Japanese screens, again, like there's a natural division between each area. So, you know, even just from an interpretive level, there's a lot of ways that you could look at it as like a fan kind of spinning or, you know, a hawk over a day. And kind of nice thinking about how you could live with this sequential image. And this piece is really cool too, because this is kind of like the Indian pieces I was showing before, where the division is between this cloud here, but every little story kind of takes place in a different environment. So there's the illusion that maybe it's all one plane and there's just the cloud going over it. But when you really look at it, they don't actually connect all the way. So each kind of pocket being a different story or maybe a different time, you don't totally know all the details, but the more you look at it, you can kind of see these different worlds concurring. So, I mean, I don't have much of my work in here, but here's something. And this is, yeah, so this was trying to look at, you know, kind of these planes existing in space and maybe how you can interpret it together. So, I mean, a lot of the work that I make that's installation-based, I try and think of how I can make it read kind of like a comic, I guess. How I can place images in a way that leads someone through it and leads them to maybe like see story or see a connection between these things. Yeah, and how to make it work in a space. So this in particular, like these are all on silk and it was next to a window. So it would kind of change throughout the day and give this like very like ethereal experience. And the piece is all about, I guess, restraint. So the imagery, there's like Ikebana imagery, and then also, you know, kind of this thing that reveals that is, you know, as controlled and constrained as you might be occasionally, you know, you don't always notice everything about what's going on. So yeah, kind of looking at all these things and thinking about how it can exist in space again. This is a piece of the Voynich Chronicles, or the Voynich Manuscript, which is still debated today whether or not any of it is like real. It's a language that no one at all understands or has any basis to figure out, I guess. It's up at, is it Harvard? No, it's at Yale. And so someone bought it basically, and as people started studying it, they found no basis for translating what's written in it. So to me, that's interesting because, you know, everything else we feel like we've kind of figured out. But something like this, you know, they're not even sure if it's a hoax or not, or whether it's just someone who's insane. So the only things we can understand from it are the things that are illustrated. And from that, we kind of can, you know, make conclusions about what the content is. But it's still not enough to actually know what is written in it. But it's pretty trippy. Yeah, and because no one can understand it, it's definitely become a basis for like making theories and claims and conspiracies. So like, this is something that someone wrote about it. And people have a lot of ideas about what it's doing, which, you know, I think is really interesting. Getting, you know, much more contemporary, you know, hobo writing and symbols pretty much developed in the Depression era as a way for people who were travelers or homeless or, you know, just living that lifestyle to find safety, to find food, to find shelter. And it was coded enough that, you know, no one else could really understand what it was. So you'd have to be indoctrinated into that lifestyle to see and understand these messages. But they were really essential in, you know, creating a life that could be more stable and safe for people who didn't have necessarily like homes or jobs or income. Yeah, so you can see like, you know, most of the stuff if you just saw somewhere, you would have no real basis for understanding what was necessarily going on. Like maybe the train is pretty representational. But so by making it more, you know, more abstract was definitely a way of protecting the language and protecting these safe spaces for people. And of course, you know, signs, they're pretty international. You know, I haven't done a ton of driving in other countries, luckily, because it is scary that, you know, as much as you recognize signs, even the little differences sometimes can throw you off. As far as what things you're supposed to do where. But for the most part, it's all pretty standardized to a point that people who are drivers can understand a lot of what they see. And it's just, you know, it's a safety thing. The more, you know, globalized this information is, the more likely it is that people are going to be able to understand it country to country. Of course, there's like environmental specifics to those things of like, you know, not everyone's gonna have dancing crabs in their country. So, you know, if you're not familiar with that, then it might be hard to know what exactly it's trying to tell you. But they are descriptors of their environments too. And looking at subways also, I never really thought about this that much until going to some other countries, particularly like Mexico City, where a friend pointed out to me the fact that their subway line is very much coded in symbols and colors. And that is because a lot of people who move to the city aren't necessarily literate. So the code was definitely created for anyone who comes to the city to really learn about how to get around and be capable of getting around without being able to read. So, you know, most of the symbols are extremely descriptive of where they're going. You know, they might have to do with the monument, they might have to do with the history of that area, they might have to do with a certain resource that's there. So they're a really like highly efficient coded way of helping people get around. Even looking at like prison tattoos, you know, Russian prison tattoos, I think like people are more and more kind of obsessed with that. And it is its own language. It's actually a really, you know, was a very effective language and is still probably for that environment. And getting to learn what these things mean if you're going into that system, I would think would be pretty essential in knowing like what you're up against. So figuring out how to code, like if someone has a, you know, a devil or something on their hand, understanding whether or not you should be scared of them, whether or not they're gonna be your friend, learning a lot about people just through like the symbols they cover their bodies with, and whether or not, yeah, just like reading that code could be essential for survival in certain circumstances. But that's interesting too, because that code has definitely changed in different ways. You know, like even the teardrop now, you know, used to have, I think, a pretty solid meaning of like, well, I still actually don't actually know. Is it killing someone or having someone revenge? One of those. But now I feel like it's come up more and more where, you know, when you see face tattoos now, it's a little bit less less dramatic or something, or it doesn't have as like deeply embedded meaning to the culture. So you can see those things change over time, and you know, and the way you read into them definitely is affected by society and society's development and changes and context. This is some examples of this like bliss symbol language, which I actually learned about from like a podcast and then looked into it more. And it's really cool because it is a contemporary written language that's non-phonetic. So it was developed for intercommunication between, the goal was for everyone. The guy who created it wanted it to be extremely international and basically have, you know, a utopic ideal of everyone not really, you know, talking or like having verbal communication anymore, but all using this. And it didn't really take off, but there's one school, I guess, in Australia that started using it for a lot of, for kids that had a lot of developmental disabilities and couldn't necessarily use verbal language and couldn't necessarily use phonetic written language. So this kind of became a standard for them. And I guess one of the things that happened though is that it did become, they started changing it based on their, the words that were more important to them and nuancing it based on their specific, you know, subgroups' importance. So even, you know, the idea of a universal language or something kind of still can become obsolete because every community has its own purposes and needs for language in different ways. And there's no way to kind of standardize what each community needs or wants to say. And so, and I mean, the same how with, you know, with sign language, there's so many different versions. Because there's really, you know, every society has different things they need to express and different ways that they express it. This is all part of a kind of symbolic visual language created by this French movement called the Lettres. And this is like hypergraphy. So Isidore Issou, who created basically the movement, which was kind of part of Dadaism, he wanted to create a like all-encompassing visual, written, poetic art language that would be, yeah, like the, you know, the most powerful written language ever. And that was also really specific, I guess, to an elitist group. And here's some examples, like different artists had different variations of it. I don't think it ever took off as far as people understanding it. They tried. And they even made up their own sounds, like new parts of the alphabet that you could only express through sound. Looking even, you know, comics has its own language as well. These are things that, you know, I guess coming out of context, you could maybe understand some of it. But even just a thought bubble or cloud is pretty abstracted. And also, you know, in comics do a lot to emphasize sound. So the way that it manipulates text gives you a stronger impact. It makes you read something as sound, which is also interesting. You know, the simplest things, as a squiggly line coming off a coffee cup tells you it's hot. Something that is, you know, you kind of see it, but it's still, it's not actually steam. It's a pretty abstracted form. And even like, you know, these kind of symbols of someone being dizzy or drunk. A lot of that, you know, we just know from reading comics that what those things mean. Some more kind of, you know, highly utilized symbols. And so this kind of a breakdown of some of them, which, you know, they're kind of funny, like the popped up vein, a rune used in manga to convey anger, is pretty specific and weird. But I think most people now like can read that in an instant, you know, without even thinking about it. Or even swearing, how it's just kind of like a jumble of symbols together, but it gives the sense, like the way it's presented gives a sense of like anger, hostility, or you know, this kind of reaction. And manga faces in general, I think, are pretty crazy in terms of like the expressiveness of different types of eyeballs and different types of little affectations on a face. You know, like this, all the different little nuances that, you know, I can't even describe some of these emotions in words, but you get the idea when you look at the face. And so again, like, you know, in my work, just because I work in comics form, my work doesn't necessarily look exactly like comics that you'd expect, but, you know, I've started adopting more language from comics, just as a way to, like, play with the form and use things that are already there for me to use. Even, like, you know, using panels that are similar to maybe, like, a Sunday strip. Or even, you know, using word bubbles where, you know, the idea is just to say that there's some kind of communication happening, but not telling you what it is. And using, you know, even here, using the kind of like pause symbol for music. So kind of pulling in these different elements that are recognizable, but maybe not using them in traditional ways. And so, of course, you know, as technology moves on, you know, this is all the most simple, basic, little bits of expression that we can have, but, you know, we wouldn't use this if it wasn't somehow important, I guess, in terms of communication, of saying something, you know, that words can't. It sounds silly, but obviously it's so important in the way that we do communicate with one another. Like, showing a smiley face is just so much better than saying, hey, I'm happy. Or like, that's a good idea. You know, it gives it, you know, and having at the end of a sentence too, it gives a context to that sentence that you can't necessarily just use language for. And even getting into, you know, I really get used to the way certain people do their smiley faces. And they have their own language for it. You know, like, I don't know, I go back and forth between using the like dash nose. But you really get used to certain people doing it and using it in certain ways, and you learn exactly what they mean by it. And like, you know, this is something that was really fun too. I forget what this is called. ASCII. Yes. And even, you know, people getting into creating images out of form again. It's basically concrete poetry. So seeing how like the overall image is affected by the language that's used in it or around it or the symbols, you know, like a rose in ASCII isn't that romantic, but it's funny. But then, I don't know, like the way that those things affect each other, I think are really cool to look at. And of course, emojis. You know, just the fact that people can have conversations in just emojis. And as much as a lot of it is kind of universal as to you'll probably understand what anyone means, there's just this level of subjectivity to it where everyone's gonna have their own kind of own uses for it, or like inside jokes that may not be understandable all around. And like, I don't know if anyone's ever played this game, but like this is a really fun way of thinking about how we look at images. For the most part, these are simply like descriptive of the plot of the movie. But even that's amazing that you can do three images and know what someone's talking about, know exactly the movie that they're referring to. But sometimes they do ones where it's like the images are the sounds that make up the title. There's a lot of different ways to do it. And this is actually a book that came out pretty recently. Called From Point to Point by Zhu Bing. And the whole book is done with, you know, without words. And it has a very specific plot. I haven't actually read it all the way through, but it is, you know, it's definitely like very broken down into a narrative. So, I mean, for me, like, especially looking at emojis and looking at, I mean, just looking at things now where, like, comics are kind of, I would say, you know, they're not taking off necessarily more than ever or anything. People say that a lot. But they're definitely taking off as forms of communication and information. Like, I have, you know, I have, like, cousins who teach elementary and middle school. And they, you know, in more recent years, they're like, oh, you do comics, like, I'm teaching this graphic novel in my class, or like, you know, all my 8-year-olds are reading this comic. And they're now like engaging with me on that topic because it's getting into these different areas of life more and more. And to me, I think a large reason that's happening is, and why I'm able to do a presentation like this, is because the internet gives us a different way to explore visual language. So to me, it's like connecting all these different ideas on this one equalizing platform. You know, the fact that I can look at the all these different things and begin to visually place it all together and see the things that are overlapping and the things that happen at different periods of time and kind of create this like system of understanding for them and why that happened. Because otherwise it's like, you know, if you go to a museum or you look through books, they're all, you know, every book, as much as you might have them all laid out together, they're going to have different contexts or they're going to show it in different ways. You can't isolate elements as much. And in a museum too, like you go to one wing and then you go the other. You don't get to see things next to each other in order to compare similarities or to compare differences. So by placing them all in this world that you get to isolate things and explore things and view it all on this really like, you know, democratic platform, I think just has opened up minds, our minds in order to understand how these things might all overlap. And even just make us better understanding visual language and visual and to interpret visuals quicker than we have in a long time. So even, you know, looking the difference between viewing an archive in this kind of, you know, linear sequence or a gridded sequence, looking at the differences of your search terms, you know, it gets, the use of the language too becomes much more nuanced as to what search keys are going to get you where you want to go. So figuring out the words to find the images or to find the end becomes a little more nuanced. Like the huge difference between searching marble sculpture versus seeking Greek marble sculpture. So the way you begin associating those images with that language now has developed in a much more specific way, I guess. Even looking at, you know, where Google's like guessing what you're going to think. So it also gives you insight into how other people are thinking and searching and the results that come from that. So woman reclining versus woman reclining painting are, you know, end up being fairly different searches. So kind of learning to hone in on your use of specific language and specific image. And I think that's something that's like really unique to now. And to making these comparisons. Yeah, so again, woman reclining painting Ingra. The like level of refining of the language really changes the result. And for me also, a huge part of that is being really active on the internet all the time. You know, as much as like to some people might think the amount of time I spend on Tumblr, Instagram is a waste of time or I'm addicted or something, I'm actually building my aesthetic every day. And just like learning the visual cues that make up my art and make up my own language. Because when you put all these things together, no one else would do this exactly like I would do this. So I think that's why it's, you know, it's such a big thing. is you're really, yeah, it's like a way of really getting into what your language is. And so this is like, you know, these are both different archives of mine. So even in that sense, I can start seeing certain patterns over time based on like how long I've been collecting images online. And yeah, and that really tells me something about my own interests that I might not already be aware of, which, you know, I don't think everyone is. Yeah, and the different ways that's displayed, you can start kind of putting images together on your own. I think it's really, you know, it's a really fun game even, or way to test yourself and a way to build sequences or narratives. And so that does, you know, I try and like think about that a lot when I'm working on my art and how people will read these different things together, even though they may seem disparate at one point. They are part of the same language that I'm building. And even if I do have different resources or references, when put together, it all is very much like my voice. Yeah, and even like, you know, I think too, as people begin to understand that, you see a lot of platforms where it is being taken advantage of now. So even like the Instagram grid, there's ways to utilize it in order to tell certain stories or to show sequences of time and events or people. And I'm excited as that starts unfolding more. I think it's still very, very early stages. But, you know, to me, those are really important sources and really important things to look at in terms of how visual language is developing now and how you can take everything that's happened over the past X thousand years and it's now a resource for you. So that is where I'm gonna leave things off. But yeah, I mean, so I guess we're open to questions for a while. Yeah, ready?
Yes.
Great. Yes.
First of all, I'm not sure if I want to thank you. But before I met you, I hated emoji, and now I'm okay with it.
Okay.
So I guess.
Well, they're going to be around, so.
What?
They're going to stay around.
I know. I think you helped me realize that.
Good.
I'm trying my best to stay old. So, my question is your work, and I'd love to see more of it if you have a chance to like, talk to you
yes.
about that. But your work is beautiful and I love it. But it's also very understated. And what you just showed was this intense barrage of visual information. How on earth are you not get overwhelmed by it? Because it doesn't show in your
yeah.
own work. It does show, say, in Ryan Chippendale, who you showed, or some of the other stuff. Like, they are taking this overwhelming barrage of information and turning it into something slightly less overwhelming. But you turn it into these really delicate, crappy things.
Yeah. I mean, I think I have levels of distillation of information. First of all, being that I have 7 tumblers, so I have a really intense archival system. And I mean, for instance, too, as you know, this is today's lecture. Well, actually, my desktop doesn't look so bad. But, you know, this is kind of like how things start and how information starts getting to different places. Yeah, and like more and more, I'm trying to be better about this, where like for different projects having their own folders of like images or references or inspirations. But I think, yeah, like organizational systems are really, really great. And mine probably doesn't make sense to everyone else. You know, that's something about it too, is we all have our own way of sorting through these things. But I think I have it set up pretty well to go through it. I mean, a lot of times when I'm like starting a piece, the first thing I do, when I'm starting a drawing, one of the first things I do is go back to my Tumblr. Should be, oh.
Well.
I'm on it, right?
No.
I'm so excited.
What am I asking you?
Well, whatever. It's fine. But yeah, I mean, I feel like maybe I can find a thing. I think the Hester show is a good one. So like, if I go into, so this, yeah, this is like my life here. So for instance, the silk pieces that I showed you, you know, here's like the final photos of the installation and all the pieces. But this is the folder beforehand. So, what in here? It's mostly scans, but then also, oh, what's this? Research, there it is. So just putting, sorry. So just putting kind of together these folders where like, that I wanted to play with certain types of imagery. So I found all these paintings of women looking in mirrors from art history, and then also started pulling up a bunch of ikebana pieces, and just kind of like throwing all this stuff together and then thinking about the ways that it connected, I guess. And as the piece developed, you know, I leave things pretty intuitive or loose, where like, this is enough for me to just do something and then kind of look at it and be like, oh, what, you know, what is the message that's coming out of when you put these things together? You know, a certain, like something kind of with vanity, but then also with control. So like trying to read into that and then breaking it down as far as I could get of what, how can I represent these things where you have just enough information, I guess, to understand what it is. And then how can I connect those things? And then how can I put language on those things to make it even more, I mean, to make it not obvious necessarily, but to give certain descriptors, to give these little clues and keys to ways of understanding it. So that's really like a typical process for me. And like keeping little collections around.
Can you show us that show real quick? A little bit larger, so we can see
how that translates into the work. Sure. So this was a group show, so there's a lot going on in there, but this was, and then each little one. Yeah, and I mean, the titles to these definitely help give another clue into what's going on. I mean, thinking of it on kind of all levels of the way that someone is taking it in. I don't know if I have the titles for these ones, but like, I guess these guys too kind of have things. But like, I forget these titles, but those also had to do with like what was going on. Because both of these pieces are part of this narrative that's about, it's about a character exploring this very like strange abstracted space, and being frustrated about not being able to find this like orb. But I mean, the idea behind it was more of the process of like searching through your brain for information or for lost things. So the titles kind of gave it more context as to what was going on. So it's not just this really like straightforward, you know, it's not just this woman, it's kind of more about this mental process and reflecting that through a character. It jumps around in different ways as to like how I'm using these visuals in language and characters. But yeah, a lot of it does come from like absorbing massive amounts of visual information and then seeing what I can learn and pull from that all the time. Yeah.
And one piece with the silk hangings, do you approach like one of those, like a sort of gallery installation differently than a Bones page?
Definitely.
So how do you approach it differently than
Well, even like these pieces are an example too, where this was a comic that I made for a show. But I mean, one of the big, there's a lot of differences, one of which is like, the format. So in a comic, someone's going to be reading it probably front to back, probably page after page, and you know, and reading it probably at once. So they're like, it's an intimate experience. It's an experience that happens all at once. They're probably very focused, so it's like, you know, they're fully engaged with all of the material that I'm giving them. Whereas in a gallery or an installation, someone walks in and it's like, you scan the room, and then maybe you go the back, or like, you know, I have no idea which direction anyone's gonna go. So it's immediately like problematic to expect someone to read something sequentially. Just because even like at an opening, or if there's someone else there, there might be people in the way of that process. Even if you have instructions, like no one's really gonna like totally read it sequentially. And you know, because maybe your friend shows up and you turn around. There's this, all these other little elements that are going to get in the way of forcing someone to do that. So, I mean, I really do try and think about what's, you know, what's gonna happen. Like, for the silk pieces, you're gonna see them all at once. So that I already know. And so just making it like, it's like really a loose narrative. And being aware of that, because in that case too, you see the full image of everyone at once when you walk in the door. And then understanding that people, you know, will get closer and kind of look at it one by one. And they're close enough that they will probably see it all at once too, when they get closer to it. And then also knowing that they won't know the titles until they go read the sheet that's in there. So to me, that's like a fun thing of like, ooh, like that's gonna give them a little like bonus information, or like it'll give it context at the end after seeing it. So yeah, kind of really thinking about the experience of what that space is gonna do makes a big difference. So even like this is a 4-page comic, and it is kind of sequential, but it's also kind of not, where each one has elements of what I'm trying to say in different ways. And even like the way the show ended up being hung, they're not all in a row, or they're not all on the same wall. So kind of knowing that people will kind of go in and out of this, they may not even, you know, understand that it's one character, but that's okay, because it's more about different ways of approaching this idea of the concept of like someone, of this like internal search, I guess. So really allowing for much more looseness into the frame of mind that someone's gonna approach something with, and the like, even like the time they'll spend with it. Yeah, so kind of trying to make it work as this like, you know, really like fast experience, and seeing what I can get into that, and seeing maybe like, if someone comes back to the show and, you know, halfway through the time it's up and it's getting like quiet in the gallery, that they could get more out of it then. And if they, you know, bought it, they could get even more out of it then. Yeah, so really just keeping in mind that there are so many different elements between those two formats is important. And because, oh yeah, I can keep going. Sure, go.
No, I'm sorry. I was wondering, how do you, from such a massive amount of information, how do you condense it into one story or one, I don't know, theme of sorts? Like, how do you, what's the process behind that? Because I understand you have all these images, you take what speaks to you, and then you create your artwork. But what's the thinking to the gallery show? Like, how do you decide exactly to put it together? I don't know, that might be a really dumb question.
I mean, for longer
like
stories.
Like, for example, like, how did you just, like, I don't know, what's the
metric? Some of this kind of came out of originally, I did do a longer story that kind of had a similar character, and I really liked her, and I liked her tone, and it was, because it was kind of, yeah, I mean, it was basically just, like, a naked woman in an empty space. So this was kind of like taking her and then putting her into I mean, kind of putting her into a space, but also, yeah, just seeing like what else I could do with her. And I was looking at, for this too, like it changed because I was looking at all these, I have a file, I'll show you. I was like looking at archways in medieval art. Because I don't do a lot of space. I usually, yeah, like I don't do a lot of environmental content in a lot of my stories. So it was kind of, I mean, for me, that was like a personal challenge. And so I was trying to look at, whatever. So I was trying to look at things that I could relate to or interested in spatially. And so I ended up collecting all these images of like archways and looking at how, like how these created really weird dynamic spaces that were kind of like labyrinths. And a lot of them really didn't make any sense, I guess. Where they kind of become these like mazes and passageways. And because they definitely, you know, there was a level of artistic interpretation in a lot of them, and even like weird play with dimensions. So, I mean, that was kind of how I got to some of that. But like, but yeah, like a lot of these spaces don't make sense and they're like flattened in weird ways. So I just was like finding something that I could relate to. And then seeing, yeah, like trying to put my character in a space that had some of those qualities and exploring that from there. So I mean, that, yeah, that kind of thing happens a lot. I mean, if I could show you my Tumblr, I like really, if I'm just like starting super fresh on something, then I usually go to my likes and I just like scroll and see what's there. Because yeah, like, cause I'm doing that on such a regular basis. I just like build up all this material to sort through later. So starting with that and then drawing little elements that come out of it, and you know, and a lot is like scrapping those things too. But seeing what things, what elements kind of come up over and over again and being like, oh, what's that about? Maybe I should think about it more. And even, yeah, and like sometimes with longer stories, I usually have an idea kind of ahead of time. So then from that too, like looking at visuals and seeing how I can adapt those to the story I have loosely in mind. Yeah, go talk.
I guess we're also asking variations on the same question, but so let's say you do have a story in mind.
He's just gonna log you on.
Oh, yay.
Oh. Is this the other computer? Oh, okay. Use this computer
that it's logged on to.
Oh, okay.
Cool. Yeah. So we just, I'm just realizing that it's over there.
Yeah.
Oh, we have to just switch that.
You can go to another class if you want to stay. I think you should go to another side.
Which is
jelly.
Yeah.
Oh,
I think I forgot my real username. So I'm on the wrong Tumblr. This one's you don't need to see this. Don't worry about it. But I mean, I guess I was just gonna show like the weird systems I have to break down these things. Where is this? Not that you should. Don't worry about Hotmail. I feel like I had the same. Well, this might just be my fault now, entirely. Oh, there it is. Anyway, so I mean, I don't know how many people use this, but like, my likes are pretty intense. It goes through many different things, but it is just like a starting off point of just like taking in a slightly more refined visual set of information. Instead of just the dashboard, this is at least like, okay, I know I like these things. So looking back through it is like one more level of bringing in my search. Versus like also just looking at like, what did I just post? Oh yeah, I did, this is you, Margaret. Which is so nice. So yeah, even like looking at a million different things. This, and like this Tumblr specifically, my like first one or whatever, is, it's pretty much all like reblogs and art and some photos and comics, but it's pretty like art-based. This is like another one that I do a lot, which this is all screen captures, like that's my criteria. So it's like even more like zeroing in on specific information or specific language, and and so like dissecting things that are already out there, instead of just like reblogging a whole image. This like narrows in a different way. And also, and for some of this too, like it's content that I create or content that I'm like gathering from my own sources. So it gets pretty weird on here. It goes back and forth between like different little elements of like art history, to like a lot of clippings from different articles online, even like results of funny little searches. And so seeing certain themes develop too of like, this one showed up a lot as like human sized chessboards. You know, I don't know if that's ever gonna come up, but it makes for a good search. It's different types of faces. And then I have one that's just like promotional. I have one that's like all kind of like fashion, lifestyle. I don't know. I have like some collaborative ones. I have, you know, this one, I haven't worked on this a long time, but this is like mostly all environmental things. So just having, just like collecting all this stuff in different ways. This is good to hear though. Anyway, it's a skip. So this is really how it works for me. And I don't know if anyone has ever done this, but what is it? Tumblr Mosaic, I think? Yeah, Tumblr Mosaic, you're right. When I first, I mean, this has been around for a long time, but it's still, I get a lot of pleasure out of it. So it takes, I mean, it's like, it's an archive, but it kind of mildly randomizes and jumbles it to this beautiful, just like tile format of everything you've ever posted fitting together. And this is cool because you can start to see themes over different periods of time. I've had this Tumblr for like 6 years maybe. So it's cool to go back to the very beginning and really see like kind of a survey of what I was looking at then and what I was interested in then. which is definitely a lot different from what I look at now. But even like, you know, to me too, even looking at this just really generally, I feel like you can see my work here in like the tones, in the subject matters that pop up. Like, I feel like it's really a super clear reflection of my work and how my work comes out of this. I mean, that's just something that I always think is interesting. And like, same with like my Instagram or something, where it is, you know, it's a combination of a lot of things. But in the end, you know, to me, I'm so like obsessed with the aesthetics of the format that, I choose things a lot based on how I think they fit together in the grid and how they look and how that is appealing to me. And, you know, and coming from various sources of life too. So having my own art in there, but also having art history, having people, having tattoos, having, you know, all, like, everything imaginable. And for me too, because Instagram's fun since you're automatically, you're usually pairing text with it. So using that text in different ways to either, like, make a joke or make something more serious or make, like, something that visually is, like, really light, really dark. They're just kind of, yeah, just like always like developing and playing with all these different formats is just, yeah, a way to like organize all the things that are out there and kind of see where your voice comes out of it all. Questions? More questions? Thoughts? Yes.
Aidan, I really liked your talk, and I was kind of struck. I kept waiting for to see an image of a rebus, and you didn't have any rebuses, and I thought that would be, there was that period right before Hogarth where that was the fashion, to have a rebus. And so my question is, at what point does the rebus then make the sort of rhetorical function of the image so apparent, i.e. that it can be both a metaphor and a metonymy? It can visualize what it can speak the unspeakable in a way.
Yeah.
So I guess to what extent is the rebus that place where the language, I guess it's interested in your take on what a rebus is, and so maybe my question is, why aren't there any rebuses in your book?
I think that's just a general error of research. I mean, the problem with doing this is that like I am constantly thinking about new things to add to it. There was something else that I had come up when I was like, I had to just stop myself because it gets so obsessive in putting together this because there's so many forms of it. So that I take upon myself as problematic. This is perfect. And I think that this too is very expressive of like, I mean, kind of what you were saying of like the pull and take from each one, how do you have the perfect nuance of each in order to like supplement both. Which is comics to me. You know, comics isn't just this straightforward like writing, image, place on top of each other that like describe each other. The idea is how do you do just enough of each so that they'll like fulfill all these gaps that neither one can replace. So I mean that is like the ultimate challenge in comics to me, of how to find that right level of each one. To describe each other or to inform each other. So, this is going in next time. Perfect. Anyways, okay, more. Yeah.
One of the things that I was sort of struck by when I was thinking about emojis is that a lot of times, like, I both use them to clarify and sometimes to obscure. And that seems to be like happened in comics a lot, especially when you're distilling things. Like, there's always like a tension between wanting to communicate and wanting to hide your meaning, it seems to be. And so I just wondered if you have any thoughts about like how visual communication then turns into hiding meaning.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because, like, yeah, what you're saying with emojis. is, I think, really affecting people socially a lot. The first thing I would turn to is like dating or something, where now it becomes this whole game of how you're like reading into someone's emojis and whether or not, you know, and it's like creating this new level of ambiguity between people's intentions, which is like both stimulating and horrifying. The level of indirectness that people can now use is very, it's a traumatic thing, I think. But it's also, you know, it also leaves hope, I guess. Where you're like, well, like, it could have meant that, but I bet it means this. Yeah, and so I think that is, I mean, then it kind of becomes a game of personal interpretation. So, and I mean, and I think that's what makes comics also really enticing to people, is the level that you can bring yourself into it. Because it's not, you know, creating a character that's maybe just eyeballs or something, versus having, you know, having something thoroughly described in language, or just like even removed from that. So yeah, seeing the ways that you can make something relatable or not, and yeah, the information that you can manipulate to give people a different experience. Again, I think it's just like, it does create a difficult amount of ambiguity sometimes, but one that I think, in comics at least, is beneficial to the medium in terms of like having a greater audience maybe see themselves in it or something.
Just to lock it into architecture for a second, there's a famous moment in the 70s when a writer named Venturi made the distinction between putting significance into things in a way that was either or, and switching it to both and. And it has something to do with using symbols or images that have associations, but emptying them of their specific reference enough, just enough that they open up to creating new connections. So they retain the they retain the will to signify. And this is one thing that's really complicated for architecture, because we're really anxious about signification and symbols. And yet we need them, we use them. You know, when we want people to read into our architecture, we want the things that we do to kind of attach to meaning. So this, what I see in your work is a sort of collection of imagery that has particular, you know, in the first images, you know, they're, I recognize that's the window in the Giotto painting, and it meant a certain thing. And but you put it in the folder with all these other images that are like it but not like it.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, new relationships can begin to come out of it, and you're creating a whole other architecture of significance in there. And then the way you use it is about emptying as much as it is.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it does, it becomes almost like the role of curator, I guess, where it's like, what can you bring into it that will manipulate its context? And what can you take out of it that will, like, yeah, restrain its context, I guess. So being really, like, hyper-selective about how those things will or won't communicate, given its, like, original meaning or whatever. Yeah, so just, like, these little ways of tweaking things. But I mean, I think it is kind of like image curation a lot of times. And I think, and that's like kind of having the like Tumblr sources too. It's like that is very direct image curation. And so getting into that more and distilling things more, and then putting my own hand into it too, I think, you know, gives me much more control in the end. I mean, because I kind of have talked about with different people before, like work of mine, you know, some things that are almost like really straightforward, mimicking things from history. This is a bronze hairpin. And I've done a bunch of these, which is just like basically me trying to make something that I saw in a museum. But the fact that it's like by my hand and the imperfections are all assumed by me, I guess it's like kind of, I feel like it gives me this ownership over it, and kind of takes it out of history, but also engages it with history, and with whoever, you know, with that time period or with those people. Yeah, it's a weird relationship, but I feel like for me, just because I'm so obsessed with that, with looking at work from every period of time, this is kind of like the way that I allow myself to partake in it too, and also kind of and become like part of that dialect. Yeah.
Art or history here? I was wondering.
I don't teach much at all. This, yeah, which is, I don't know. I can talk a lot, but I think it's good to reserve it sometimes. But yeah, I mean, I work full time as an artist in New York, and yeah, luckily have been doing more and more talks and workshops. Like, I'm so thankful to be down here for this week. Because otherwise, I'm like in my room doing this alone and like storing away information and images and making these connections and just being like, oh yeah, oh my God. So it's great to get to share that. And yeah, I'm just kind of like, even for me, like trying to boil down this process and boil down these thoughts into a way that I feel like people can understand it. And also hopefully relate it to things that they're working on. Yeah, because I feel like I see these connections, but you know, sometimes if you're just in your own little world, it's hard to yeah, explain it, or it's hard to like, you know, I understand my process so much better from compiling like the slideshows that I like did this week. I think, and for me, it's super beneficial to do this.